Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rajkishore Sharma from Chemistry Department, University of Delhi. Today, we are going to discuss about the module Introduction of Energy Dispersive X-ray Spectroscopy. This is under the paper of Surface Analytical Techniques 2. The contents of this lecture are: what is Energy Dispersive X-ray Spectroscopy? Then, how this energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy came into existence. What is the underlying principle of EDX technique? Answers of all these questions will be covered in the upcoming slides. So, here we begin. To begin with, I would like to give you the brief of this module. Initially, we will be studying about the basics of energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, or commonly known as EDX. What exactly it is. Then we will proceed to the background or history of energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. History includes the inventions, discoveries, along with the name of the scientists and the year. Next, we'll be going through the physical groundwork and various quantum numbers, that is their classification. Moving on to the next, we will be studying the magnetic quantum number, spin quantum number, principle or phenomena of EDX, and requirement of EDX. Now, what is EDX? As said before, EDX is energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. It is a technique which is used for the analysis of a sample for its elemental or isotopic composition, or to measure the material structure and their characteristics. EDX involves the use of X-rays. Now the question comes, what are X-rays? X-radiation, composed of X-rays, is a form of electromagnetic radiation. Electromagnetic radiation is a form of energy that is all around us and takes many forms, such as radio waves, microwaves, X-rays, and gamma rays. Most X-rays have a wavelength ranging from 0.01 to 10 nanometers. These X-rays are those which have high penetration power and can be used even for small particles. These X-rays are produced by the excitation of the inner shell by incident electrons. Energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy involves the excitation of the electrons to a higher energy state, and in doing so, it is required to input the energy from the surroundings. When the electrons return back to the lower energy level, there is a release of energy to the surrounding. This results in the transition between the different energy levels. Each element in the periodic table has a unique atomic structure that corresponds to a unique set of peaks. X-rays can be generated by an X-ray tube, which is a vacuum tube. X-ray tube is a vacuum tube that uses high voltage to accelerate the electrons released by a hot cathode to a high velocity. The high velocity electrons collide with a metal target, the anode, creating the X-rays. Metal target is the anode, which creates the X-rays. In medical, X-ray tubes, the target is usually tungsten or a more crack resistant alloy, ruthenium and tungsten, in which the composition of ruthenium is 5% and tungsten is 95%. But sometimes molybdenum, for more specialized applications, such as when softer X-rays are needed, as in mammography. In crystallography, a copper target is most common with cobalt. Cobalt often being used when fluorescence from iron content in the sample might otherwise present a problem. Electromagnetic radiation, or EM radiation, is a form of energy that is all around us and takes many forms, such as radio waves, microwaves, X-rays and gamma rays. Most X-rays have a wavelength ranging from 0.01 to 10 nanometers. These X-rays are those which have high penetration power and can even be used for very small particles. Moving further in the EDX analysis, first question is, what is EDX and how it works? When an atom or molecule make a transition from high energy state to lower energy state, a peak is obtained and element can only be recognized from its peak energy. The nature and amount of element in the compound can be evaluated from the integrated peak intensity. The systems of EDX are connected to various electron microscopy instruments like scanning electron microscopy, or commonly known as SEM, transmission electron microscopy, TEM. Through EDX, composition of the sample is being interpreted by observing different peaks that are typical characteristics of different elements. When an electron present in an inner shell moves to a higher energy level, a hole is created in the inner shell. The hole is occupied by the electron present at higher energy level, which results in emission of characteristics X-rays with energy corresponding to the difference of the energy of the two levels. In turn, when an electron in the higher energy level shifts to a lower energy level, there occurs a transition which is equal to the difference of the quantum number, particularly orbital angular momentum. When the atom in the excited state changes to the ground state, an OJ electron is emitted in preference to the characteristics X-ray emission. EDX system along with scan electron microscope can be coupled to the transmission electron microscope, which is commonly termed as analytical electron microscope. The basic principle in both the cases are same. Then the same EDS identifies the major trace elements, where as in TEM EDS, electron beam penetrates the sample resulting in more refined manner. The major difference between X-ray and OJ electron is the probability of emission in X-rays increases with increase in atomic number, whereas the emission probability of OJ electron decreases with the increase in atomic number. Moving on to our next slide, we have history of EDX. As we know that X-rays are involved in EDX analysis, these X-rays were discovered by William Rongton, an achievement that earned him the first Nobel Prize in Physics in 1901. To add to your knowledge, I would like to tell you that in honor of his accomplishment in 2004, the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry named element 111 Rontingum a radioactive element with multiple unstable isotopes after his name. EDX involves many other scientists too. Let us know about them. In 1949, the Raymond Casting devised first static beam electron microscope. Question that must be coming across your mind is, what is an electron microscope? The electron microscope is a type of microscope that uses a beam of electrons to create an image of the specimen or to model an image of the specimen. It is capable of much higher magnification and has a greater resolving power than optical microscope, allowing us to see much smaller objects in finer details. They are large, expensive pieces of equipment, generally standing alone in a small, specially designed room and required trained personnel to operate them. Now, moving further into history and the development of EDS systems attached to SEM or TEM, the microscopes involve a new objective lens that allows the passage of X-rays, diffraction crystal and the detector, which is called as Geiser crystal. In 1986, scientists developed the first lithium drift silicon SILI detector to measure X-ray photons for different energies simultaneously. During 1970, the silicon lithium detector gained popularity as this was very versatile. with more development, there were alternatives of silicon lithium detectors. The first alternative was high purity germanium detector, which offers higher efficiency and better resolution. Since germanium was having greater efficiency, the overall spacious resolution can be improved by adding a collimator in order to narrow the beam of emitted X-rays. The diagram is in front of you. Then in 1983, silicon detectors came back again and were called as silicon drift detectors. There were certain modifications, but the main underlying principle was same. Group of scientists developed a system that operates at room temperature with pleasant cooling. This helps in making complex applications like identifying inclusion in ultra-pure material or specifying the complex chemical composition of aggregate particles. The diagram of silicon drift detector is shown in this slide. We can see that there is an anode in the center through which X-rays will be passed. Drift fields will be produced. Principle of EDAX. Energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, often called as EDS or EDX, is a qualitative as well as quantitative X-ray microanalytical technique. It provides information on the chemical composition of a material for elements with atomic number higher than 3. Now, we will talk about the characteristic X-ray generation. The atoms are ionized by the primary beam, leading to holes generated on the core shells. This follows ionization of the electrons from outer shell to fill the holes and cause the emission of X-ray fluorescence lines. The characteristic X-ray lines are named according to the shell in which the initial vacancy occurs and the cell from which an electron drops to fill the vacancy. Considering the following cases, if the K shell is vacant and electron drops from L shell, as shown in the image, when electron drops from L shell, a K alpha X-ray is emitted. However, if the electron drops from the M shell, the emitted X-ray is K beta. In a similar manner, if the L shell electron is ejected and an electron from the M shell fills the vacancy, L alpha radiation will be emitted. All these are shown in the background image. As shown in the image, when an electron, of course from the beam, strikes an atom, it ejects an electron originally positioned in an inner shell. The electron positioned in an inner shell, that is K shell. To return the atom to its lowest energy state, the vacancy is immediately filled by an electron moving from a higher energy shell in the atom. In doing so, this high energy electron must release some of its energy in the form of X-rays. As a consequence, the energy release is expressed in electron volts. So, as a consequence, the energy release is exactly equal to the energy difference between the two levels shown in figure 3. The X-rays with K beta radiation possesses more energy than K alpha radiation. The energy difference between M and K is higher than between L and K. However, because the most probable transition is the L to K movement, K alpha radiation will always be more intense than K beta radiation. All elements except hydrogen and helium produce characteristic X-rays. In addition, practical restrictions concerning a minimum energy level usually exclude the measurement of lithium, that is 0.052 kilo electron volt, but all other elements beginning with the beryllium K shell, that is 0.108 kilo electron volt, can be assessed simultaneously. X-rays in the range of 100 electron volt to 20 kilo electron volt are readily measured with a silicon lithium, which is represented as SILI or SDD detector. And this range can be extended to 100 kilo electron volt with an HPGE detector, the germanium HPGE detector. It is the energy dispersive approach that provides the great practical value of EDS, as it enables access to virtually the entire periodic table except the low atomic numbers, that is hydrogen, helium and lithium. For many years, the only X-ray window material available for EDS was beryllium. These windows performed well for energies above 2 kilo electron volt, but low X-ray energy performance was non-existent. For selected STEM applications, windowless installations became the norm. Then alternative materials with low X-ray energy transmission became available, including BN, boron nitride and diamond. Ultimately, ultra-thin polymer film windows became the standard. The basic foundation laid for EDX, or we can say physical groundwork laid by the set of four quantum numbers, that is principal quantum number, angular quantum number, magnetic quantum number and spin quantum number. To start with, principal quantum number will be represented by small n. In quantum mechanics, the principal quantum number designated by small n is one of four quantum numbers which are assigned to each electron in an atom to describe the electron's state. Now, the second one is angular quantum number, or sublevels, will be represented by small l. The azimuthal quantum number is a quantum number for an atomic orbital that determines its orbital angular momentum and describes the shape of the orbital. The azimuthal quantum number is the second of a set of quantum numbers which describe the unique quantum state of an electron. It is also known as orbital angular momentum quantum number, orbital quantum number or second quantum number, and is symbolized by small l. The third is magnetic quantum number, described in an orbital, and we represent it by small m. This also tells the orientation in space. It distinguishes the orbital available within a subshell and is used to calculate the azimuthal component of the orientation of orbit in space. Electrons in a particular subshell, such as S, P, D or F, are defined by values of L, that is 0, 1, 2 or 3. The value of m, small m, can range from minus L to plus L, inclusive of 0. Thus, the SPDF subshells contains 1, 3, 5 and 7 orbitals each with values of m within the range of plus minus 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3 respectively. Each of these orbitals can accommodate up to 2 electrons with opposite spins, forming the basis of periodic table. Now, the last one is spin quantum number, small s. The spin quantum number is the fourth of a set of quantum numbers which completely describe the quantum state of an electron. It is designated by the letter small s. It describes the energy, shape and orientation of orbitals that describe the spin or direction, clockwise or anticlockwise, in which an electron spins. We will study about each of them in details in the subsequent slides. Now, to begin with, the first, the principal quantum number. In quantum mechanics, the principal quantum number, as said before, is one of the four quantum numbers which are assigned to each electron in an atom to describe the electronic state. The principal quantum number is always an integer. As n increases, the number of electronic shells increases and the electrons spend more time farther from the nucleus. As n increases,
the electron is also at a higher potential energy and is therefore less tightly bound to the nucleus. This describes the size of the orbital or energy level of the atom.
As n increases, the electron is also at higher potential energy and is therefore less tightly bound to the nucleus. The principal quantum number was first created for use in the Bohr's model of an atom, distinguishes between different energy levels. With the development of modern quantum mechanics, the simple Bohr models was replaced with a more complex theory of atomic orbitals. Now, we come to angular quantum number. Each principal energy level may split into closely spaced sublevels as denoted by L. This quantum number may be more precisely named the orbital shape quantum number, as each orbital in a given type of sublevel has the same electron cloud shape. Two quantum numbers, N and L, are required to specify a particular energy sublevel.
Angular quantum number, L, or sublevels. For example, when L is equal to 0, the orbital is spherical. For each principal energy level designated by small n, there are n sublevels, that is, n value of L. L is equal to either 0, 1, 2, 3, up to n minus 1. Sublevels are commonly given letter designations, like the L is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, while sublevels are designated as S, P, D, F, G sublevels. Moving on to the next quantum number, we have magnetic quantum number. Each orbital within a particular sublevel is denoted by its value of m. The quantum number may be more precisely named after the orbital orientation quantum number. In each energy sublevel that is designated by small l, there are two l plus 1 possible independent orientations of the electron cloud. Each orientation is defined by a value of mi and is termed as an orbital.
All orbitals in a given sublevel are of equal energy and are termed as degenerate. In the presence of a magnetic field, their different orientations led them to have different energies. Three quantum numbers, n, l, and m, are required to specify a particular orbital. Moving on to the last set of quantum number, we have spin quantum number, we represented by small s. An electron spin on its own axis as denoted by m. There are two possible directions of spin, that is plus half and minus half, which is known as clockwise and anticlockwise. As we know, a spinning charge generates a magnetic field, and electron has a magnetic field associated with it. The electrons in the same orbital are most stable when they have opposite spins, that is plus half and minus half, due to magnetic attractions.
Gives a complete pictorial view of the quantum numbers. In this diagram, we can see that the number of electrons in each subshell. The shape of the S shell is spherical. The shape of the P shell is dumbbelled. The shape of D shell looks like a dumbbell, but with a donut around the middle. F shell dumbbells again, but now with two donuts between the ends of the barbell. Now, each orbital can hold maximum of two electrons. This means S shell can have two electrons. Similarly, P shell can further three subshell, each having the capacity to hold two electrons. This means P shell can have total of six electrons. Let's talk about D shell. It has further five subshells. So, the total number of electrons it can accommodate is 10. Last but not the least, F cell. It has 7 number of subcells. So, the total number of electrons that can be accommodated in F cell are 14. Let's now study about the phenomena of SIMS, or the underlying principle of EDX. Students, you can also see the flowchart along with the diagram, which help you more to understand the concept of EDX. When the sample is bombarded by scanning electron microscope, that is SEM, the electrons are emitted out from the atoms containing the sample surface. Ejected electron creates an electron vacancy, which is filled by electron from a higher state, and a high energy beam, that is X-ray, is emitted to balance the energy difference between the higher state and the lower state. The X-ray which is being emitted out is unique for every element. The EDX X-ray detector is used to measure the amount of X-rays emitted versus their energy. When X-rays reaches the detector, it creates a pulse charge. That pulse charge is equal to the energy produced by X-rays. The charge sensitive preamplifier converts charge pulse to voltage pulse. This signal produced is sent to a multi-channel analyzer where the pulses are stored by voltage. The energy, which is determined by the voltage measurement for every incident X-ray, is sent to the computer for display and data interpretation. So, that is how the EDX works. Describes the basic requirement of EDX. The components of energy dispersive X-ray system are, most important is the electron beam, then of course the sample to be analyzed, semiconductor detector furnished with a field effect transistor, preamplifier, cooled to a sub-ambient temperature, and main amplifier that helps in further amplification and a fast pulse inspection function. All of these parts are controlled with a computer assisted system like multi-channel analyzer, that is MCA, or a computer assisted X-ray analyzer, that is CXA. We will be discussing each of them in details in our next module. The diagrammatic representations of EDX analysis. You can see the X-ray tube, the X-ray is falling on the sample. Further, they are reaching to the detector, then moving to the amplifier for amplification. And at last, but not the least, you can see our results on the computer screen.
At last, let's conclude energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. EDX is an analytical technique that is used for analysis of an element or chemical characterization of a sample. It is based on exploration of a sample through interaction with electromagnetic radiation and matter. The incident beam excites an electron that is present in inner shell, ejecting it from the shell and creating an electron hole at its original position. The amount of energy that is released depends on the shell from which it is being transferred as well as to the final shell. The position of peak having characteristic energy gives information about the elemental composition of the sample. Thank you.